Hello and welcome. In this lesson, I'm going to show you how to use Xcode to build user interfaces with SwiftUI. I'm going to first teach you how to preview your app's user interface so that you can actually see what you're building. And then we're going to take a look at how to use Xcode to visually construct the user interface, or UI for short. Now, up until this point, the lessons have been more or less passive, meaning that you can just sit back and watch the lessons. But starting from now, we're going to take a more active approach. I want you to watch what I do, replicate it on your own Xcode project, and attempt any of the challenges that I have for you at the end of the lesson. This is the best way to learn, and quite frankly, if you're only going to be watching the lessons without trying it out for yourself, you're not making the best use of your time, and I speak from personal experience. Now, just in case you're new around here, hi, my name is Chris, and welcome to Code with Chris, the place to be if you want to learn how to make an app. Before we begin, I have a quick question for you. Do you have an app idea that you're trying to build? Let me know by leaving a quick comment below. And on your way down there, if you wouldn't mind, please give this video a thumbs up because it really helps out the video. Thank you so much for that. All right, this time we're gonna get our hands dirty. So let's do it. Let's start by creating a brand new Xcode project. We're gonna choose iOS app. And I'm going to call this one UI test. Just make sure interface is SwiftUI, lifecycle is SwiftUI app, and language is Swift. Other than that, you can name it anything you want. Let's go ahead and save our project. And like I mentioned in the previous lesson, contentView.swift represents your view. But as you can see, it's all code. So how do you actually see what your UI looks like? Well, there are two different ways. The first way is to launch your app in an iOS simulator, like I mentioned before. So let's go ahead and do that first. Select one that you fancy. So I'm going to select iPhone 11, and I'm going to hit this build and run button. Now, if it's the first time you're launching the iOS simulator, it's going to take a while to boot up, just like it would be to boot up a real device. For me, because I've launched the simulator before, it's happening really, really quickly. As you can see, by default, your project has a Hello World label. We're going to talk about that in a second, but first, let me show you the other way you can preview your app. So let's go ahead and stop our project, and that's going to stop the app from running in the simulator. The second way is to preview your app in this canvas right here. That's part of the editor area. If you don't see this, you can click on this little button here and make sure that there's a check mark beside canvas. And if you're looking at a .swift file, which is a view, you're going to be able to see this canvas. Otherwise, if you're looking at this entry point file here, you can see that there's no preview. So let's go back to content view, make sure we have our preview here, and click resume. It's going to build and run it, and then you're going to see the preview here. Again, if this is the first time you're doing it, it might take a little while. Let's use these zoom controls down here and zoom out a little bit so that we can see the whole thing. Now, just off the bat, there are a couple of things I want to mention here. This is simply a preview, whereas when you launched it in the simulator, you're actually installing that app in a virtual device so that you can interact with it and test it. Here, this is a preview that you cannot interact with, but there is a way that you can. So if you click this button here, live preview, it goes into a mode where it's just like the simulator that you saw before, but it's in this preview canvas. So you can go ahead and hit stop, and then again, it just becomes a normal preview that's only for previewing purposes. Another cool thing about using this preview canvas is that you can hit this button here and you can choose a different device. You can choose a layout, you can choose dark mode or light mode, and you can pick a number of different things. This is the preferred way to preview your UI because as you are building your UI through code on this side, you're going to be able to see things change on the right here without having to relaunch the app in the simulator. All right, now let's dive in and talk about how we're going to actually build the user interface. So make sure you have contentView.swift highlighted and go ahead and hide the file navigator. Now there is a bunch of code here that make up the view, but we're going to go through it in depth later on when you learn some of the Swift programming basics. For now, to avoid confusion, I just want to draw your attention to one thing, which is this piece of code right here. What I've highlighted on the screen is what is generating this label here that you see in the preview. Notice that we have a text keyword. We have the hello world piece of text that you can see here. And we also have this padding element here, which gives the padding around the word. Let's take a look at this piece of code and break it down. I'm actually just gonna go ahead and delete it. As you can see, Xcode is gonna throw all sorts of complaints and errors, but don't worry, we're gonna fix it right away. Now, our user interface elements have to live in between this opening bracket and this closing bracket. And you can only have one user interface element. Now, obviously, that doesn't make sense because our user interfaces are made up of more than one element, but that's where container elements come into play. And I'll show you a couple of those in this lesson as well. For now, let's recreate that text element. So what we write is that text keyword, followed by a pair of brackets like that, rounded brackets. And then inside there, we have a pair of quotation marks, and then we put the piece of text that we want to display. So here I'm just going to put hello. But you'll notice that this blue frame wraps very tightly against my hello text. If you wanted to add the padding back, then you would write dot, and then you would just type in padding, and using autocomplete, you can just select that one right there. And just like that, we've recreated that label with padding. This right here is the text element or the label. This part with the dot padding, this is called a modifier. And you can think of a modifier as an attachment to an element that changes the look and behavior of it. In this case, this padding modifier adds padding to the text element so that if there's an element right beside it, there will be some space surrounding our text element. And there are actually many more modifiers that we can add to our user interface elements. For instance, I can add one called background, and I'll just add it to the end of the padding one. And I'm going to say that the background for this label should be blue. So you can see that our preview canvas very nicely represents what we're writing here through code. If there's any time that things get out of sync, maybe the code you're writing here is saying the background should be green, but you're not seeing it here, the code is considered the source of truth, because ultimately the preview canvas and even what you see in the inspector panel are just visual representations of the code. And that brings me to my next point, which is when you're building the user interface, you don't have to write code. There are so many visual ways for you to build the code. Let's erase this text element again, and let me show you some of the ways in which we can visually build the user interface. I talked about the library panel before, so you can see here that we can simply search for the text element, select it, and we can drag it into our code editor right here. And then we can change the placeholder text, but we don't even have to change the text here. If you click on this text element and you go into the inspector panel, you can change it here like that. And then also in this inspector panel, you'll see that there are a bunch of modifiers that we can add. So to add the padding, I could click this to add top padding only, and you can see that the code changes and it's specifying that I only want padding on the top, and you can see it reflected here. Or I can click this one here and turn padding on or off. And you can see now I have padding on all sides. So in addition to some of the modifiers that you see here, down here, there's a text box where you can search for more modifiers. So I can search for the background one and click that, and then select that blue background, as you can see here. And then I can also add that padding. Now, in addition to using the modifiers that you see here and using this add modifier text box, you can also use the library to add modifiers. So this first tab gives you all of the user interface elements that you can add to your view. Here on the second tab are modifiers. So as you can see, there's the padding one, there's the background one. So how do you go about adding these modifiers? Well, you just click and you drag it. But here you have to make sure that you drag it to the end of the code, because if you accidentally drag it in the middle of your code, it might not take, or you might get something like that. That clearly is an error. So let's undo that. So as if that weren't enough, there are a couple more ways I want to show you on how you can modify your user interface elements visually instead of writing code. First of all, let's finish configuring this background, and we're going to select blue right there, or maybe green. Okay, that's not changing that. So it is changing that, but it's not changing here. So I'm going to go ahead and select color, and okay, we can do green, right, lowercase g. All right, so you can hold down command on your keyboard, and then you can click on the user interface element from your preview right here. And then there are a number of things you can do with that element, including this one, show SwiftUI inspector. And then again, you get this add modifier text field, which you can search for modifiers to add. So I'm going to add one called blur. You can see that it is blurring the color green. And you can see that now my background is a blurry green. Now you can do the same thing on the code editor side. So you can hold down command and you can click the text element, and you get this menu. You can again click show SwiftUI inspector. And from here, you can see that this menu looks like the inspector here. And we can also add modifiers as well. So to illustrate my point, I've shown you a whole bunch of different ways for you to modify your user interface visually. You don't have to write the code, but over time, as you're doing this in the visual manner, you're seeing the code that is generated over and over again. You're going to get to a point where it's so familiar, it's going to be faster for you just to type it out rather than clicking everywhere. So it's a really neat way to learn the user interface code. Isn't that pretty cool? Xcode has come a long way. It used to be really fussy to use the visual interface builder with Xcode, but SwiftUI really has changed things for the better. Now, just to recap, you learned about the text element and how to use a modifier to customize its look and behavior. A modifier is something that can change the look or behavior of a view element. You also learned that the user interface is built from Swift code. But however, there is a multitude of ways in Xcode to visually build and construct your UI. Now, the cool thing is that as you're visually customizing your UI through the preview canvas or the inspector panel, the code in the code editor is updating and changing accordingly. So this is a great way to learn the Swift code. To reinforce what you've learned today, I have a quick quiz and challenge for you. To access them, simply visit codewithchris.com and log into or create your own account, and then enroll into the 14-day beginner challenge. And there you can access all of the quizzes and challenges. I highly recommend that you go and do that to make your learning really effective. Now, the next time we sit together, I'm going to be expanding your tool set by introducing additional views and containers. If you don't want to miss that lesson, make sure you hit that subscribe button and turn on bell notifications. All right, I'll see you in the next lesson.